Welcome back. Today, we are going to read the story titled, I Am George Washington, and this is another book in our Ordinary People That Changed the World series. So let's go ahead and see what this is all about. I Am George Washington, written by Brad Meltzer, illustrated by Christopher Eliopoulos. I am George Washington. You know what one of the hardest things in life is? Being the first. When you're the first to try something new, there's no one to show you the way. But when I was little, I wasn't the first. I was the fourth of 9 children. That's a lot of brothers and sisters. How do you think I learned how to deal with people fighting? When I was really little, I lived in a place called Mount Vernon, which had a huge river running through the backyard and unexplored forest in every direction. At 5 years old, this was the world I knew. If you wanted to explore the forest, you had to be the first one to go inside. Think you're brave enough to go in there, George? Not yet, but soon. People will tell you that I was the perfect boy. They'll say I didn't lie after I chopped down a cherry tree, but that cherry tree story isn't true. Like most boys back then, I liked swimming, fishing, and riding horses. I was a decent athlete, but nothing spectacular. Mostly, I was an ordinary kid. I liked books, and I even liked to dance. I was great at it. In school, my best subject was math. I was pretty good at writing, but I was a terrible speller. You spelled beginning wrong, and harvest too. Don't you realize I'm going to be one of the world's best leaders? I believe that almost as much as I believe you're a great dancer. But remember I said that it's hard to be first? It's easier when there's someone showing you how it's done. This is my brother Lawrence. He was 14 years older than me. No one had a bigger impact on my life. What are you wearing? My military uniform so I can fight for our country. You like it? It's amazing. I loved hearing the stories of his adventures. Thanks to my brother, I knew I wanted to serve in the military. Soon though, I saw how uncertain life could be. When I was 11, my dad died. We couldn't afford proper schooling, so my brothers had to teach me at home. I didn't go to high school or college, but I was committed to learning and building myself. You spelled it wrong. Then I'll do it again. As a boy, I copied all the rules from the book of virtues. There were 110 in all. Number 11, don't gnaw your nails. Number 12, don't stand too close to people when talking or you'll spit on them. Number 100, don't use a fork or knife to clean your teeth. Instead, use a toothpick. The most important was the first one. Every action done in company ought to be done with some sign of respect. I guess that one covers spitting on people too. When I turned 15, my mother told me I needed to get a job. Since I was good at math and precision, I became a surveyor, someone who explores large areas of land to find their boundaries. At 16, I went with a wealthy family called the Fairfaxes to survey the Blue Ridge Mountains and the Shenandoah Valley. There were no roads. The rain was fierce, and one night, the straw mat I was sleeping on caught fire. The next night was even harder, but we kept going. Don't give up. There was something special in treading a new path, something beautiful in doing what no one had ever done before. Just being around the Fairfaxes changed my life. They helped me get work. I observed how they lived, how they dressed, and how they ate. I even learned how to properly dance. He really does like to dance. That wasn't a joke. I was a great dancer. At the Fairfaxes, I ate with fine silver and beautiful china. At home, I ate with sticks at a fire. It was as if I was living in two worlds, but to me, both were equally important. You know you can eat with the rich folks every night. Yes, I know. When I was older, I joined the military. In my first big battle, I was on the British side fighting against the French and Native Americans. I was nearly shot 4 times. 4 musket balls ripped through my clothing, but nothing could stop me. While others were screaming, I raced across the battlefield, keeping people calm. We lost the battle, but I became the commander of all of Virginia's fighting forces. At the age of 23, I ran for office to be a member of the House of the Virginia Legislature. I lost. That's right, I lost. Next time, I'll be better organized. It didn't stop me. I tried again, and this time, I won. In fact, I won re-election every time after that, but the world as I knew it was about to change. Remember when I was growing up, the United States didn't exist yet? Back then, there were no states, just colonies, all of them controlled by England. We were ruled by a British king named George III. The king is unfair. He wants us to pay more for everyday things like stamps and tea. We deserve to be free. In April 1775, the first shots were fired in Massachusetts in Lexington. It took 8 days for the news of the new American Revolution to reach me. Are we going to let the colonists in Massachusetts fight alone, or are we going to join them? It was one of the biggest questions in history. The answer came at a meeting called the Second Continental Congress. Our 13 colonies decided we would fight together against King George III. All we needed was a leader for the battle. Guess who they chose? You look like you're in charge. Some say it was because I was a natural leader. Some say it was simply because I was taller than everyone else. But let me tell you a little secret. I was the only one wearing a military uniform. It wasn't an accident. On that day, I came ready to lead, ready to do the job, ready to be the first. Was it easy to be in power? Never. Our side didn't have enough food, clothing, or weapons. Their side was well-fed and well-armed. Our side didn't have trained soldiers. We were farmers and fishermen. Their side was the greatest fighting force in the world. In the winter at Valley Forge, some of our troops didn't eat for days. They wore rags and had to go barefoot in the snow. So how do we win? We were smarter. We wrote plans in invisible ink so the British couldn't read them. Cool, right? Invisible ink? My code name was 711. We were sneakier. We launched surprise raids like this one where we crossed the Delaware River. But most important, we wouldn't give in. They were fighting for a king. We were fighting for a cause, for freedom. Also, let's not forget, we had a weapon they'd never have. We had General George Washington. After we beat the British Army, a new government was formed. I presided over the convention and wrote our constitution, which created new laws for our country. The brand new United States of America was free to explore its own future. Now all we needed was to pick our first president. Someone brave, someone strong, someone trustworthy enough to handle all that power. Again, guess who they chose? You know, you're so popular you could have made yourself King of America. Yes, I know. At the end of the American Revolution, King George III asked someone what Washington planned to do after the war. The king was told that George was going to return to his farm. If he does that, King George said, he will be the greatest man in the world. And that's exactly what he did. And he did it again when he left the presidency after his second term. Some say it was my most heroic act. Instead of putting myself first, I put my faith in my country. I put my faith in you. In life, there are many ways to lead. You can be a quiet leader, a tough leader, a bold leader. But leadership isn't about being in charge. It's about taking care of those in your charge. When you're in a position of power, always look out for those who put their faith in you. Always forge your own road, because sometimes the most important trail is the one no one has ever taken before. When you do those things, you will clear a path. That will lead the way for others. Every year we still celebrate his birthday. President's Day is a national holiday. He's got the only state named after a president. He was even on one of the country's first postage stamps. People think he wore a wig, but he never did. He powdered his hair white, which was the style back then. I just like that he wore fake teeth. They weren't made of wood, though. They were made of ivory. Gross. You can see them at Mount Vernon. Leadership doesn't come from charisma or personality. It comes from courage. The courage to do what's right. The courage to serve others. The courage to go first. I am George Washington. Today they call me the father of our country. I have the courage to do what no one else has done before. And here is George Washington's timeline, and here's a quote. I hope I shall always possess virtue enough to maintain the character of an honest man, George Washington. So here you see a portrait of George Washington, and I read in a book that he never smiled because he was embarrassed of his fake teeth. And then here you can see Mount Vernon, which is George Washington's home, and a mask of George Washington's face upon his death. And here you can see a picture of his fake teeth, and it says gross, right? And that is the end, and I hope you learned some new facts in our story today. One thing I found interesting was that he was only 67 when he passed away, which isn't that old. And also, the whole teeth thing I can't get over. And also, I heard that they were made from ivory, but I also heard that they were made from other people's teeth. So it'll be really interesting to read about that as you get older. So anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed this book and we'll talk to you later. Bye.